Namaste. Welcome to the second session on financial inclusion. As you are aware, in an earlier session, we covered the introduction to financial inclusion, the extent of financial inclusion, and also the need for financial inclusion. In today's session, we will cover, again, recap the extent of financial inclusion, the credit policies of institutions, the availability or non-availability of timely and cost-effective credit in rural indebtedness. As you're aware, I'll recap the definition of financial inclusion. The Indian economy in general and banking services in particular have made rapid strides in the recent past. However, a sizable section of the population, particularly the vulnerable groups such as weaker sections and low-income groups, continue to remain excluded from even the most basic opportunities and services provided by the financial sector. In order to address the issues of financial inclusion, the Government of India constituted a Committee on Financial Inclusion under the chairmanship of Dr. C. Rangarajan. The committee submitted its final report to Honorable Union Finance Minister on 4th of January 2008. The financial inclusion was defined as the process of ensuring access to financial services and timely and adequate credit where needed by vulnerable groups such as weaker sections and low-income groups at an affordable cost. The committee also looked into the issues involved and suggested measures for bringing the excluded population into the ambit of the financial system. Measures submitted by the committee are expected to provide access to comprehensive financial services to at least 50%, 55.8 million of excluded rural households by 2012 and the remaining by the year 2050. But first, let us look at this slide, which shows you the measures of the financial inclusion. Here you would see that in India, if you consider that the number of rural households are 147.9 million, then out of these, 89.35 million households are of farmers and 58.55 million belong to the non-farming households. Out of these farmers' households, small and marginal farmers constitute 74.97 million and other than small and marginal farmers are 14.38 million. Out of these small and marginal farmers, financially excluded are 40.27 million, a huge number, and financially included are 34.70 million. And other than the small and marginal farmers, financially excluded are 5.66 million and financially included are 8.72 million. However, when we talk about providing the financial services in the rural sector, we see that there are some limitations to providing these services in the rural area, which are limited staff, poor infrastructure like education, housing, staff of the financial institution which is not oriented to marginal operations, functional style not cost beneficial for generating viable operations, too much documentation, time taken for loan sanction, lack of viable scheme for implementation, and opportunity costs for loans is perceived to be very high. Other than this, technology is the basic need for achieving the aim of financial inclusion. Strategy for technology generation and transfer should be of two types. A lot can be achieved by effective dissemination of already existing improved technologies. Generating more technologies of the same potential as existing one would not be of any use at all. There should be adequate, accurate assessment of existing technologies. Then reasons for these technologies not reaching the intended users need to be identified. New technologies need to be developed in frontier areas. and frontier areas, meaning the remote rural areas. Similarly, because of growing competition due to globalization, technological upgradation assumes greater significance. This should be done through application of modern science, taking advantage of advances in molecular biology and other sciences. Harnessing benefits of technology generation requires well-developed system for sales and distribution of seeds, for example, and plant propagation material. Till now, public sector dominates multiplication and supply of seed and plant propagation material, but it is highly inadequate to meet the emerging and growing needs and demands. There are also reports of some decay in the public system distribution of seeds, etc., on account of several reasons. The advantage of this is being taken by unscrupulous private traders. There is a need to promote competition in seed sector by encouraging large-scale private sector participation in seed business. Other technological upgradation needed are, and here I am talking about the banking sector or the financial institutions, the issuance of smart card, handheld terminals, central CPU, installation of low-cost automatic teller machines, mobile phone banking, SMS banking, public call office, PCO connectivity, allow branchless doorstep banking in remote, low population density areas, usage of biometric smart cards, mobiles, reach the last mile village. This is very important. We have to reach the last mile village. Transaction ID should be convenient and hassle-free. It should be cost-effective and accessible. Now, the smart card needs to be provided to every customer and point of sale machines for reading and writing smart cards for transaction. In the slide, you would see that I put up a slide telling you how this works. As you would see in the slide, there's a web camera for photograph. This is the business facilitator who's sitting with something which looks like a laptop. And there's a web camera for photograph where he photographs the individual who comes for opening an account. He has optical biometric scanner for fingerprints, pad for signature capturing, battery power pack for undisrupted enrollment. And it is through these machines that it captures the data of the person whose account is to be opened and subsequently uses it for accessing the transactions in the account. Then, other than this, once we've opened an account, we have got the customer to deal with an organized sector, some financial institution which belongs to the organized sector. But this is the first step. Now, what is needed is, in order to improve the economy of the nation, apart from opening the account, what is more important is the credit. And now, let us look at this slide, which talks about the output vis-a-vis the credit. How effective has the credit been in the increase of economy of the person concerned? The issue of farm credit assume significance in view of allegations of suicide by numerous farmers due to crop loss and indebtedness. Amid a spate of suicides by farmers due to alleged loan burden in the various parts of the country, a noted farm scientist has suggested formulation of an agriculture credit policy with thrust on rain-fed areas, user-friendly insurance instruments, and spread of institutional arrangements. There is urgent need for an agriculture credit policy with emphasis on rain-fed areas. Flow of credit to marginal and small farmers in rain-fed areas must be increased, said Debakar Nayak, head of agricultural economics in Orissa University of Agriculture and Technology, OUAT. The debt trap is a major cause for suicide by farmers, since most peasants depend on money lenders and non-institutional credit. steps are needed to be taken to extend institutional credit to marginal and small farmers with proper monitoring mechanisms for productive use of loans. Availability of credit to farmers should be made easy, that is point one, and at a low cost, another very important point. Frequent visits of farmers to credit agencies should be reduced. Further, new credit products like pledge financing, credit for marketing, loan against warehouse receipts, and export credit should be extended. These are new policies which should be seen, looked into. Credit should be extended on specific project basis by linking farming process to nearest agriculture experts for proper technical advice and final product to the market. Now, if you would recall, in the earlier session, I had talked about that financial inclusion not only means that you should open accounts, give credit at an affordable cost. That was one part of the whole session. But what was important was advice played a very big part of the financial institution. You have to advise the farmers about new technologies, when they should take credit, how they should take credit, and where exactly should they take credit for. So it is very necessary that a setup should be arranged so that there is somewhere where the farmers can go, whom they trust and they can take advice from. The government has also asked the newly formed Farmer Commission to look into the matters of suicide by farmers. The state government and state agriculture universities should have joint responsibility towards improving the credit absorption capacity by the farmers. Due to lack of absorptive capacity, the impact of credit on productivity has been marginal. This can be illustrated by the following table, as you can see on the slide, where you would notice that in the year 1998-99, value of input as a percentage of output was 19% only. And it has not increased much in the year 2003 to 2004, bottom of the table, you would notice that it is now 20%. Not much improvement. Now, having seen this, let us have a look at the rural economic environment. The international financial sector witnessed a major collapse during 2008 and 2009. Brought about by the subprime crisis in USA. The tremors of the global economic crisis were felt in India too, though with lower intensity. The contribution of agriculture and allied sector to the growth rate of the GDP during 2008-2009 was 1.6% as compared to 4.9% during 2007-2008. The Indian economy registered a GDP growth of 6.7% at 99-2000 prices during 2008-2009 due to consistent high growth trend of these service sector, which was 99.7%. The share of the agriculture and industry sector in total GDP, however, declined to 17 and 26% respectively, while that of the service sector increased to 57% during 2008-2009. The savings and investment ratios during the 10th plan stood substantially higher at 31.4% each compared to the 9th plan. Agriculture in India is in the hands of millions of peasant households, a bulk of which comprises tiny land holdings with preponderance of owner cultivation. There's hardly any direct government participation in the production and investment decisions of the farmer. But the government does influence the legal, material, and economic environment in which the farmers operate. though tremendous progress has been made to exploit irrigation potential in the country, still two-thirds of the area under cultivation is unirrigated, and there is thus heavy dependence of production on vagaries of nature, that is, rainfall. Irrigated areas have experienced sharp increase in productivity level, and large part of output at such farms is for markets. On the other hand, productivity in unirrigated areas has remained either stagnant or experienced very small growth, and most of the farmers in such areas produce for subsistence only. At overall level, agricultural growth remains slow, below 3% in the country. Apart from that, agriculture growth remained confined to a few well-endowed pockets, which has created regional disparities. Here I would like to quote from a critique by Mr. Ramesh Chand on India's national agricultural policy, which describes agriculture as the backbone of Indian economy, mainly because of three reasons. One, agriculture constitutes largest share of country's national income, though the share has declined from 55% in early 1950s to about 25% by the turn of the century. Two, more than half of India's workforce is employed in the agriculture sector. Three, growth of other sectors and overall economy depends on performance of agriculture to a considerable extent. Besides, agriculture is a source of livelihood and food security for large majority of vast population of India. Agriculture has special significance for low income, poor and vulnerable sections of rural society. Because of these reasons, agriculture is at the core of socio-economic development and progress of India's society. And proper policy for agriculture sector is crucial to improve living standards. Therefore, the new agriculture policy faces some challenges. For example, and these challenges can be grouped together in roughly four categories. One, relating to growth. Second, substantiability. Third, efficiency. Fourth, equity. There are also other important concerns like food security, livelihood, employment, improvement of standard of living of agricultural population. Addressing these challenges requires efforts on several fronts like incentive structure, infrastructure, technology, market development, extension, regulation, input supply, tenancy, etc. New agriculture policy should address above challenges through efforts in the above mentioned areas. And the National Agriculture Policy document aims to attain output growth rate in excess of 4% per annum in agriculture sector based on efficient use of resources. It seeks to achieve this growth in a substantial manner and with, like I said earlier, equity. The policy resolution that describes in detail the strategy and policy alternatives, which are grouped under the following heads. One, of course, sustainable agriculture. Second, food and nutrition security, generation and transfer of technology, input management, incentive for agriculture, investment for agriculture, institutional structure, and of course, the risk management. Tremendous efforts are needed in development of irrigation in the country to help attain growth rate stipulated in the National agriculture policy. This would require very sharp increase in public investment in agriculture, which has remained either stagnant or followed decline during the last two decades. It would not be an exaggeration to say that for creating such a magnitude of irrigation potential would require trebling of public investments in real terms. Second, expansion of irrigation through conventional means like major irrigation projects is likely to face resistance from various environmental groups. Here I'd like to bring to your attention the Narmada problem that we had. That dam was constructed in, I think, four times the cost at which it was envisaged because of various environmental problems or groups who agitated against its construction. So that has to be looked into and taken care of. Incentive for agriculture. Agricultural policy repeats the policy concerns echoed in the beginning of the Green Revolution to provide favorable economic environment for promoting farm investment through 1. Removal of distortion in the incentives. Secondly, improvement in terms of trade with manufacturing. Thirdly, external and domestic market reforms. This is most important area for policy actions. The document states only the intention but does not elaborate how it would be achieved. Some reforms which government has initiated in these areas are liberalization of land lease market, proposal of change regulation to promote contract farming and private market. Another important factor in the agriculture area is the investment. The purpose of investment in agriculture is to generate capital in the form of infrastructure, improvement of quality of natural resources and assets, and creation of productive assets for promoting long-run growth and improving efficiency in production and marketing. This investment in any sector comes from two sources, that is, public or private. While public investment is meant mainly to create infrastructure, private investment is used mainly for asset formation and for improvement in quality of existing assets. Traditional agriculture and agriculture in underdeveloped countries is generally starved of investment resources because private capital is deterred by the risk involved in agriculture and institutional investment has been meager. Therefore, special efforts and attention are required to direct and induce public and private investments in agriculture in underdeveloped countries. In the recent years, there has been renewed interest in public and private investment in Indian agriculture. This has been induced by serious concerns for secular decline in public investments in Indian agriculture, which began in early 1980s. This shows that infrastructure development for agriculture sector failed not only to keep pace with the growth of the sector but lagged far behind the growth of the sector. There is some comfort that like the decade of 1980s, decline in public investments did not cause decline in private investments even during 1990s. Now we'll carry on to the institutional structure. National Agriculture Policy advocates land reforms by focusing on consolidation of holdings, redistribution of surplus, wasteland among landless, tenancy reforms, development of lease market, and recognition of women's rights in land. Other areas listed for policy attention are private sector participation, through contract farming, assured markets for crop, especially for oilseeds, cotton, and horticulture crops, increased flow of institutional credit, strengthening and revamping of cooperative credit system. Out of these, some policy concerns like land lease markets have already been discussed earlier. The land consolidation has assumed greater importance due to large-scale fragmentation of land holdings, due to division of inherited property and certain other factors. Division of land parcels into smaller pieces scattered over space has become so complex that their consolidation by revenue authorities, as witnessed during first two decades of planned development in some states, would not help much but would leave it free to revenue officials to use their authority to show favors and disfavors. Having gone through the agriculture policy, we now realize that a document should be drawn up for a new sustainable agriculture policy. And this is what, if you would look at the slide, this is what we have envisaged. That sustainable agriculture policy should aim to promote technically sound, economically viable, environmentally non-degrading and socially acceptable use of country's natural resources, land, water and genetic endowments. This indeed is a tall order. Downside risks are unlimited, upside benefits seem to have a ceiling. So, to sum up, we can say that the desirable agriculture policy should be or should recognize that there is, firstly, no easy quick fix solutions and should initiate exercise to understand the cost of delivering rural financial service products in a scientific manner, should examine activity-based costings, allow banks to exploit rural areas. And here, when we use the word exploit, we mean that it should allow the banks to reach, like we said earlier, the last mile village, the last possible remotest standing person. It should leave operational decisions to the institutions, that is the government, should leave the operational decisions to the institutions, should continue to remove bottlenecks for microfinance to flourish, should continue to direct branch licensing towards rural areas, should continue to provide targets for rural lending, friendly insurance instruments, raise credit and insurance literacy, linkage through self-help groups, implement skill development program, and should provide a platform for marketing of the produce. Training and sensitization programs should be organized. Constitution of task force for monitoring loans taken from an unorganized sector by farmers. This is very important. Then also, what is required in technological upgradation is, and you'd be surprised to know, that first and foremost, you will have to de-skill the farmer. That is, they're already used to a certain method of farming, which is now obsolete. It may be traditional, but now obsolete, not giving the benefits which the farmer should reap. And therefore, he should be de-skilled. And then new technologies should be, he should be upgraded with new technologies. Inputs are moving out of the farmer control. Seeds moving towards research intensity. This is all due to the change in technology which is occurring right now. Research and extension services moving from public to private sector. Pesticides being peddled as extended services of extension and no comprehensive risk mitigation products are visible. recognizing the fact that one most important aspect of helping the farmer produce is the marketing. The government has already initiated measures to amend Agriculture Produce Market Committee Acts. This is a step in the right direction. Government needs to move fast on this, as it is very difficult to reach consensus on such reforms. The states coming forward to undertake such reforms should be encouraged, because like the slide says, marketing hymns in addition to the national income by value addition and employment creation by optimization of resource use, optimization of output management, optimization of increase in farm incomes, right? And it also helps in widening market for produce, which is very natural, and also growth of the agro-based industry. Other than marketing, insurance, another factor which is very, very urgently needed to be addressed as a part of the a tool for financial inclusion. Since agriculture has a high-risk economic activity, credit without insurance is hazardous. Farmers need user-friendly insurance instruments covering production right from sowing to post-harvest operation, and also market risk. It is suggested steps should be taken to raise credit and insurance policy. Crop insurance policy should cover both irrigated and rain-fed areas with varied premium amounts based on yield potential of the crops. Self-help groups could provide linkage to reach farmers who do not have access to financial institutions. Other than that, agriculture industry is beset with subsidies. The trend in government subsidies and investments in and for Indian agriculture develops a conceptual framework and model to assess the impact of various subsidies and investments on agricultural growth and poverty reduction, and presents several reform options with regard to reprioritizing government spending and improving institutions. There are three major reasons for this. First, initial subsidies in credit, fertilizer and irrigations have been crucial for small farmers to adopt new technologies. Small farms are often losers in the initial adoption stage of a new technology, since prices of the agriculture products are typically being pushed down by greater supply of products from large farms which adopted the new technology. But as more and more farmers have adopted high yield variety, continued subsidies have led to inefficiency of overall economy. Second, agriculture research, education and rural roads have been the most effective public spending items in promoting agricultural growth and poverty reduction during all periods. Finally, the trade-off between agricultural growth and poverty reduction is generally small among different types of investment. As for agriculture research, education and infrastructure development, they have large growth impact and a large poverty reduction impact. Several policy lessons can be drawn. Agriculture input and output subsidies have proved to be unproductive, financially unsuitable, environmentally unfriendly in recent years, and contributed to increased inequality among rural Indian states. To sustain long-term growth in agriculture production and therefore provide a long-term solution to poverty reduction, the government should cut subsidies of fertilizers, irrigation, power and credit, and increase investments in agriculture, research and development, rural infrastructure, and most important, education. Promoting non-farm opportunities is also important. However, simply reallocating public resources is not the full-time solution. Reforming institutions can have an equal, if not larger, impact on future agricultural and rural growth and rural poverty reduction. There has been considerable increase in subsidies and support to agriculture sector during this period. While public sector spending in agriculture for infrastructure development started showing decline in real term, but investments by farmer kept on moving on a rising trend. The output growth, which was concentrated in very narrow pockets, became broad-based and got momentum. The rural economy started witnessing process of diversification, which resulted into fast growth in non-food grain output like milk, fishery, poultry, vegetables, fruits, etc., which accelerated growth in agricultural GDP during the 1980s. The Union Budget 2008-09 announced the continuance of interest subvention to enable banks to provide crop loans up to Rs. 3 lakh to farmers at an interest of 7% per annum, envisaging suitable interest subvention to NABARD and 3% interest subvention on own involvement of cooperatives. Based on the recommendations, Government of India entrusted NABARD with setting up of two funds, that is Financial Inclusion Fund and Financial Inclusion Technology Fund. The FIF aims to support developmental and promotional activities to secure greater financial inclusion, particularly among weaker sections, low-income groups, and in backward regions, hitherto unbanked areas. The FITF will focus on enhancing investment in information and communication technology aimed at promoting financial inclusion, stimulate transfer of research and technology, increase technology absorption capacity of financial services providers and users, and encourage an environment of innovation and cooperation among stakeholders. Both funds have been set up with corpus of Rs. 500 crore each. Now we would look at some of the credit schemes which aim to help in financial inclusion. These are the Kisan credit cards, the general credit cards or the GCC, Laghu Udyami card, business correspondent and facilitators, SJSY scheme for poverty elevation, SHG bank linkage program, MFI bank linkage, women entrepreneurs, development programs, rural entrepreneurship program, development programs in clusters, skill upgradation and capacity building, farmers club, JLG, Jawahar Gram Samridhi Yojana, Employment Assurance Scheme, Rural Housing, Credit Cum Subsidy Scheme for Rural Housing, Wasteland Development Project, Golden Thread. Now, I'll take up some of these schemes in a little bit of detail so that you have an idea of what exactly these schemes are. Firstly, the Kisan Credit Card. Like the name suggests, It is a credit card given basically to the farmers, and it was originally issued to help as a part of crop loan. They were supposed to only purchase materials which pertained to the farming. For example, purchase of seeds, pesticides, etc., etc. But now the Kisan credit card covers both the consumption part and also a part of rural housing. It is a production credit without any flow limits. It is given to farmers. It's a revolving cash credit limit valid for 5 years. Like I said, it was primarily given for crop production, but it is also now given for capital, for purchase of equipment such as tractors and equipments, and also personal expenditure. The eligibility criteria is as per the asset value of the farmer. It attracts saving interest on credit balance, and it comes with a crop insurance on basis of scale of finance of crops raised during the seasons. Then we have the general credit card. This scheme is being implemented by scheduled commercial banks and regional rural banks. It's given to individuals in rural and semi-urban areas. This, you'll have to see, is limited to individuals in rural and semi-urban areas. It is credit without insistence of security. Banks are not supposed to take any security in lieu of giving this loan, and the maximum amount of this loan is ₹25,000. Again, it's a sort of revolving cash credit, and it is valid for 3 years. Similarly, there's a similar card which is called Laghu Udyami Card or LUC. Now, this is given for 5 years, and it is given to traders, artisans, those individuals who are involved in some kind of small business or small industrial unit, hence the word Udyami. Small is Laghu, Udyami is the business, somebody who's doing small business. Maximum amount for this card is ₹10 lakhs, and the validity is 3 years. The next scheme that we have is SGSY scheme for poverty alleviation. The purpose is very simple: bringing rural poor above the poverty line. And where is it applicable? The area where you can give this kind of loan is in, of course, the rural area. Again, it's a revolving fund, cash credit type. The eligibility is that it comes, this kind of loan is given through a self-help group which should be in existence for at least a minimum period of 6 months. The funding is from DRDA and banks. The amount of fund is minimum ₹5,000 and maximum is ₹10,000. Subsidy comes as 30% of project cost, maximum amounting to ₹7,500 in general category. In SCST category, this amount becomes 50% of the project cost with a maximum ₹10,000. Then for group loan, in a group loan, it is 50% of the project cost, maximum amounting to 1.25 lakhs. And in the group loan, the subsidy is given to individuals, and this subsidy should not exceed an amount of ₹10,000 per capita. In order to bring about a place, an area where farmers can get together and discuss their problems, and also should get the necessary advice needed in the scenario of changing technology and environment, Farmers Clubs has been instituted, and the mission is development through credit, technology transfer, awareness and capacity building. The minimum size of the club has to be 10 members and there is no limit to the maximum number of persons who can come to this club or become members of this club. The membership is both for farmers as well as non-farmers. The operational area for this club is 2 to 3 villages in a contiguous basis. If they are small villages, 2 to 3 villages, otherwise the one and only village. Then the bank linkage has to be there, that is, they have to open a saving account with the bank. And what is the role of this farmers club? Is to enroll farmers, inform agricultural events, hold 2 or 3 meetings a month, updating them with the latest news, events, and coordinate with bank for credit flow. Now the expenses to this club is borne by NABARD, which is the National Bank for Agriculture and Rural Development, and the amount that it gives is ₹10,000 per annum for first 3 years of the existence of the Farmers Club. The expenses, the mandatory expenses that one has to incur in this Farmers Club is for formation and maintenance ₹2,000, for awareness and orientation ₹5,000, meeting with experts ₹3,000. This is how the reimbursement is given by NABARD to the club. Other than this, we have the joint liability group. Again, this is a getting together of people of who are working in an homogeneous area and availing loan from the or availing credit from the scheduled commercial banks or any organized financial institution. Now JLG, as they are called, they can take short term working capital loan for agriculture. Loan is also given for allied activities in farm, other domestic requirement, education, consumable items, medical expenses, credit against debt from non-institutional lenders. Now this is becoming a very important factor, that now the organized sector, in order to wean away farmers or other backward people from the non-institutional money lenders, loans are being supplied or credit is being given by the organized sector, so that they can apply their credit for productive functions and do not lose out by giving a higher rate of interest and cost factors to these non-institutional or unorganized money lenders. It is given to tenant farmers, oral lessees and sharecroppers. The minimum number of members in a joint liability group should be 4, a maximum 10. JLG members have to indulge, like I've already stated, in homogeneous or similar activities. Membership primarily of tenant, small farmers. Members to have same socio-economic background. Members have to be engaged in agricultural activity for minimum 1 year prior to them getting the loan. Group members should not be defaulters to any financial institution. None of the group members. It is not a case of majority or minority. Not a single member of the group should be a defaulter to any financial institution. 100% refinance is available from NABARD and personal crop insurance is available. A very important concept of rural development is known as the self-help group. This concept was floated by Professor Yunus of Bangladesh through his Grameen Bank in Bangladesh. It's a microcredit to poor, like landless traders, petty traders, artisans, and other people of small means. SHG is based on the recommendation of Kalia Committee. Banks to finance small self-help groups, and self-help groups give funds to the members within its group. Again, the finance to self-help group, which shows group dynamics, financial management capabilities and behavioral discipline. Broad criteria for selection of SHG has been laid down by NABARD. SHG has to be in existence for at least 6 months before they can avail finance of any kind, and should have, just like in the case of JLG, homogeneity, and also should have successful saving from own resources. They should have a democratic working setup, maintenance of proper accounts, and if need be, support from NGOs. Funds have been set up for technological upgradation, which is known as Technological Upgradation Fund Scheme. The scheme is operated by the Ministry of Textile for technological upgradation in textile. SIDBI and IDBI are nodal agencies. Schemes are in operation since 1/10/2005. Units availing bank finance are entitled interest subsidy of 5% and a capital subsidy of 10% of purchase price of machinery for upgradation of technology. Here you would have to understand that it is for upgradation of technology. To buy other equipments belonging to the same level of technology, no loan is given. Then, linked to this is a credit-linked capital subsidy scheme for technological upgradation provided to SSI going for GTAB-approved technological upgradation for significant upgradation of technology, for installation of improved environmental condition, installation of anti-pollution measures, installation of energy conversion machinery. Subsidy is given at the rate of 15% of purchase price of machinery. Maximum amount of loan is rupees 1 crore. Maximum amount of subsidy is rupees 15 lakhs. And scheme will be in operation during 11th five-year plan period 2007-2012. And nodal agency is SIDBI. Similarly, for the development of the women, Entrepreneurship Assistance and Development Scheme has been floated, where the extension of loan facility to NGOs for on-lending to women is there for setting up small and micro enterprise in non-farm sector. Banks to give loan up to 70% of the project cost. Ministry of MSME gives grant up to 30% of the project cost. And the eligible activities are training in credit usage. This is very important. Skill development training, equity margin money for acquiring infrastructure, exhibitions and marketing arrangement. Then we have what is called the Project Golden Thread. Rural development it's a rural development project, focuses on sericulture activity, improves livelihood of poor, involves development of non-mulberry silk, namely eri or munga. Department of Panchayat and Rural Development looks after it. Project is under the special SGSY scheme. It covers all aspects from plantation to spinning with modern machines and presently has been implemented in 8 states. A most important factor of rural credit is rural housing. It is essential for socio-economic development. For example, and a scheme has been launched which was called the Indira Awas Yojana, and this was launched in the year 1985, and it's a sub-scheme of Jawahar Rozgar Yojana, primarily to help construction of developing units, upgradation of existing unserviceable kaccha house for SCST freed bonded labor, non-SCST, rural poor who are below poverty line, and the aid is granted. With this scheme comes another scheme which is called Credit Cum Subsidy Scheme for Rural Housing. It is operative since 1999 under the aegis of Ministry of Rural Development. The target group is rural household with annual income up to rupees 32,000. Mind you, it is an annual income of the household. Minimum 60% of fund to SCST is given. Purpose, of course, is the construction of new house, and the target area is rural should be 20 kilometers from any metro or large town, 5 kilometers from medium or small town. This is the criteria which has been laid down by Reserve Bank of India. Loan amount is maximum of rupees 40,000 and comes with a subsidy maximum of rupees 10,000. Cost of the subsidy is borne by center and state when the ratio 75:25. Center bears 75% of the subsidy cost and state 25%. Repayment period is maximum 7 years. Repayment of the loan. Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana. Rural road connectivity is not only a key component of rural development in India, it is also recognized as an effective poverty reduction program. Notwithstanding the efforts made over the year at the state and central levels through different programs, about 40% of the habitation in the country are connected by all-weather roads. It is well known that even where connectivity has been provided, the roads are not in very good shape. The objective of the government is to provide road connectivity through good all-weather reports to all rural habitations with a population of more than 500 persons. The primary focus of the program will be on construction of new roads. However, upgradation of existing roads will be permitted to be taken up under the program so as to achieve connectivity through good all-weather roads. Extension of existing roads to the SCST habitation in the village would also be covered under upgradation. Upgradation would, however, not cover repair of existing roads. The rural roads to be taken up will by and large be surface road, blacktopped, cement, concrete. However, depending upon the soil conditions, all weather roads may also be gravel roads, but with all necessary cross drainage structures. Another scheme which is important is the Employment Assurance Scheme, which was launched for implementation in 1778, identified backward blocks of different states. The blocks selected were in the drought-prone areas, desert areas, tribal areas, and hilly areas. Later, the scheme was extended to the remaining blocks of the country. As its name suggests, the primary objective of Employment Assurance Scheme is to provide gainful employment during the lean agriculture season in manual work to all able-bodied adults in rural areas who are in need and desirous of work but cannot find it. The work may be either on farm or on other allied operations or on the normal plan. No plan works during such a period. The secondary objective is the creation of community, social and economic assets for sustained employment and development. This is the Jabhar Gram Samriddhi Yojana is the restructured, streamlined and comprehensive version of the erstwhile Jawahar Rozgar Yojana. It has been designed to improve the quality of life of the rural poor by providing them additional gainful employment. The primary objective is the creation of demand-driven village infrastructure, including durable assets to enable the rural poor to increase the opportunities for sustained employment. So, as we have seen, financial inclusion includes not only financial services by way of credit or opening of accounts with financial institutions, but also all-round availability of various facilities, infrastructure, for example, road, health, education, technology, so that last man in the last mile village grows economically, resulting in the overall development of the country. Thank you.